Let's start in verse number 10. I'm sorry. Verse number 10. For therefore we both labor and suffer reproach because we trust in the living God, who is the Savior of all men, especially of those that believe. These things command and teach. Verse 12. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. I want you to keep that phrase in your mind, beginning in verse number 12. Let no man despise thy youth. Now turn over in your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter number 17. 1 Samuel chapter number 17. 1 Samuel chapter number 17. And look at verse number 20. Verse number 20. Now this Saul's the king at this time is the context. And Israel is going out to battle against the Philistines. David is the youngest son of his family. And at this time, David is left behind to tend to the sheep. And then David's father sends him to the battle, and he sends him there with provisions for his brothers. He's not sent there to fight, and he's not sent there, to benefit the military for Israel at that time in any way. So look at verse number 20 where it says, And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. Jesse's his father. And he came to the trench as the host was going forth to the fight and shouted for the battle. Verse 21, For Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array. And it says, army against army. Now look at verse number 22. And David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage, and ran into the army, and came and saluted his brethren. And as he talked with them, behold, there came up the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, out of the armies of the Philistines, and spake according to the same words, and David heard them. And all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him, and were sore afraid. And the men of Israel said, Have you seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up. And it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches, and will give him his daughter, and make his father's house free in Israel. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, What shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine, and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine, that he should defy the armies of the living God? And the people answered him after this manner, saying, So shall it be done to the man that killeth him. Now keep in mind, he didn't show up to fight. The reason why David showed up was just to bring provisions. He was just bringing food. He was just bringing supplies for his brethren, just for his brothers. Like I said, David was left behind because he's the youngest of his family. He's not considered old enough. He's not considered capable enough to go out to war at this time yet. But while he's there, it happens to be the time when Goliath is coming out, and he's challenging the Israelites, and he's cursing the Israelites. And what he does that makes David angry is he starts cursing and blaspheming God. And this makes David angry, and then David's like, well, basically, why isn't anybody doing anything? Why are you just standing around? Are you just allowing this uncircumcised Philistine, this heathen man, to just curse God? Now continue in verse number 28. It says, And Eliab, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, Why camest thou down hither? And with whom hast thou left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know thy pride and thy naughtiness of thine heart. For thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle. So you can see that he's just treating him like a child. He's treating him like a youth, like he's a young child. Now look at verse number 29. And David said, What have I now done? Is there not a cause? He's saying, aren't I acting the way that I should be acting? Isn't there a reason for me to be acting the way that I'm acting? Look at verse number 30. And he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. And when the words were heard which David spake, they rehearsed them before Saul, and he sent for him. And David said to Saul, Let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant, talking about himself, David says, Thy servant will go and fight with this Philistine. And Saul said to David, Thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear, and took a lamb out of the flock, and I went out after him, and smote him, and delivered him, and delivered it out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard, and smote him, and slew him. The servant, talking about himself again, slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God. So he convinces Saul to allow him to go forth to battle. And then when he goes forth to battle, look in verse number 41. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David. So they're approaching one another to fight right now. And the man that bare the shield went before him. In verse number 42. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. So three times David is despised in just a matter of 15 verses. First, he's despised, or he's disdained by his brother Eliab, which is his older brother. You know, his older brother is basically treating him just like he's a child, treating him like, why are you here? You know, you're not, you know, basically, you know, you shouldn't be here. You know, he only came to bring the provisions, and then David heard him cursing, you know, cursing God, and that caused him, heard the Philistine cursing God. And that caused him to be angry. And then Eliab just reacted towards him, just started belittling him. And then we saw Eliab, you know, look down upon David or disdain David. And then look in verse number 33 with Saul. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him. And then he says, for, meaning because, thou art but a youth. So the reason why he's despised or he's disdained by Saul is the same reason. Because he's a young man. He says, because you're a youth. Look at verse number 41 now. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, watch, for he was but a youth. So over and over again, you see a theme here of David being looked down upon, or David being disdained, or David being despised. And it says over and over again, for, meaning because, the reason why they're despising him is because he was but a youth. Now, number one of them was his brother. This is the first thing I want to point out. One of them was his own kindred, his own flesh, Eliab. Another one was a saved man, for sure, which I would assume his brother was also saved, but was who we know was 100% a saved man, Saul. And he looked down upon him, and he despised him because of his youth. And then we see a heathen man, a man that's not saved for sure. All three of these men, and they look down upon David, and they despise David for his youth. The title of my sermon comes from 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, where we were before. Let no man despise thy youth. And let me say this as an introduction. If there's any young man in here, you know, if there's anybody in here who's still a youth, and that's a young man and wants to serve God and wants to take a position of leadership just like David did, maybe wants to be a pastor or wants to be in some position of authority, you better be prepared, because 100%, it may come from believers, it may come from unbelievers, but you will have your youth despised. You will 100% have people look down upon you simply because of your age. Before you even open your mouth, before you even do anything, people will look down upon you and they will despise your youth. Now, I'm going to show that this is even more of a common theme throughout the Bible. And there's repeated verses that talk about, you know, men, women, people in general despising children or despising the youth. Look at Matthew chapter 18, verse number 10. Matthew chapter number 18, verse number 10. Matthew chapter number 18, verse number 10. This is Jesus speaking. Jesus says in verse number 10, speaking unto his disciples, his apostles, he said, take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones, talking about children, talking about the youth, for I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven. So here we see a command unto his disciples from Jesus. Unto Jesus' disciples, he says, don't despise the youth. He's saying, don't despise the children. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter number 16. 1 Corinthians chapter number 16. And we'll look at a few passages here just to show that this is a common theme, that this is something, you know, we can see a pattern all throughout the Bible. And keep in mind also, the passage that we read, one of the pastoral epistles written from Paul to Timothy, was written to Timothy. It was written to Timothy, who was training in the ministry underneath Paul. Now look at chapter number 16 in 1 Corinthians. Look at verse number 10. It says, "Now if Timothy has come, see that he may be with you." Talking about Timothy. "See that he may be with you without fear, for he worketh the work of the Lord, as I also do." So he's putting a good word in for Timothy. Now look at the first phrase of verse number 11. "Let no man therefore despise him, but conduct him forth in peace, that he may come unto me, for I look for him with the brethren." So we see another command specifically about Timothy. We saw one written directly to Timothy before, telling Timothy, warning Timothy, "Let no man despise thy youth." So when we read here and it says, "Let no man therefore despise him," we can know from reading, from comparing Scripture with Scripture, we can know why Paul was telling the church at Corinth not to despise Timothy because of his youth. Because people would commonly, you know, despise people. People will commonly despise others just because of their age, just because of their youth. Now turn to another passage, Titus chapter number 2. Titus chapter number 2. Titus chapter number 2, and look at verse number 15. And like I said, Timothy, 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy are pastoral epistles. They're written to men that are training in the ministry. They're written to men that want to be pastors. Also, the book of Titus is also a pastoral epistle. It's written to a man that is training in the ministry, that's wanting to be a pastor. Look at verse number 15, the very last verse of chapter number 2. He says, "These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority." And then he says, "Let no man despise thee." Let no man despise thee. So he gives repeated warnings. He gives a warning to the church at Corinth. "Let no man therefore despise him." Talking about Timothy. Don't despise Timothy. Then we saw a warning given directly to Timothy, which tells us why the church at Corinth would have despised Timothy. Why they would have despised him. And he said, "Let no man despise thy youth." And then right here we see another warning. So three warnings given in, here in Titus chapter 2 is the third warning, where he says, let no man despise thee, writing to a young man in the ministry. So we can compare Scripture with Scripture and see why all of these are given, why all of these warnings are given. And that's my first point, is to understand that it's a warning. When you see something commonly talked about over and over again, you need to take, you know, the more earnest heed, the more times that it's warned. So if there's a young man that has, you know, a goal, he has it set in his heart, like, "Hey, I'm going to do good things for God. I'm going to do big things for God. I'm going to do great things for God." And he doesn't want to wait until he's older, which would be best, you know, not to put it off. You know, he doesn't want to wait until he's older. You better understand that there's warnings, number one, in the Bible that are warning you that people will despise you for your youth. That's what you can infer for that. That's what you can take away from that. When he says, "Let no man therefore despise you," there's a reason why he's giving the warning. And then, just like we saw before in 1 Samuel chapter number 17 with David, we saw three times in just one situation where David steps up. And what does he want to do? He wants to be a leader. He wants to do something, you know, that has a position of authority. He wants to step up and he wants to do something great for God. And what do people tell him? How do people act towards him? They despise him. They don't despise him because he wasn't capable. They didn't despise him because he wasn't able to, you know, to fight Goliath. They just looked at him and they saw, number one, they didn't know his skills. They knew nothing about him. They just saw that he was young. They just saw that he was a youth, and they despised him, and they mocked him, and they ridiculed him, and they laughed at him. Now, you turn to Proverbs chapter number 22, verse number 15. "And they despised him because of his youth." Number one, my point number one is, understand that this is a warning. Before you make the decision to serve God as a young man, you need to understand that there is a warning given that people will despise your youth. You need to be prepared. God, everything in the Bible is there for a reason. And God warns you for a reason that there will be people that will despise your youth. And I'm sure that there are people throughout history who have wanted to serve God and have been discouraged by other men, by older men, and they ended up not going into the ministry, and they ended up not serving God and not doing great things for God. Because some old man, you know, some old guy who probably wasn't doing anything for God discouraged that young man. I guarantee that there's reasons why these warnings are throughout the Bible. There's reasons why everything in the Bible is here for a reason. So when we see commandments, you know, over and over again, we need to take more heed to them. And when we see warnings throughout the Bible, we need to take, you know, very earnest, the more earnest heed to these warnings. Now, I'm going to give you a definition of what the youth is, because, you know, some people in here may be thinking to themselves that this sermon doesn't apply to me. You know, why did I come today? Because I'm not a youth. I wasted my time coming in here. That's what maybe some people would be thinking. But Numbers chapter 30, verse 16, we're going to get, there's a few definitions of what the youth is. And now this one is to be expected. Numbers chapter 30, verse 16, it says this. These are the statutes which the Lord commanded Moses between a man and his wife, between the father and his daughter. This chapter is about vows and oaths that you're taking. And then it says this. It says, between the father and his daughter, being yet in her youth, in her father's house. So what you can take away from that is that one definition of what a youth is while a child is still in their father's house. While a child is still living in their father's house. The time period before, you know, a daughter or a son would get married. Here's another one just to back that up. Leviticus chapter number 22, verse 13 says the same thing. But if the priest's daughter be a widow or divorced and have no child and is returned unto her father's house as in her youth, she shall eat of her father's meat, but there shall be no stranger eat thereof. So notice what it said, as and is returned unto her father's house as in her youth. So it gives you a definition of what youth is. A definition. That's just one of them. Now this one right here may take people by surprise. Job, when the events occurred to Job, Job was an older man. His children were not living with him any longer. And it says in Job chapter number 29, verse number 4, he says, as I was in the days of my youth, when the secret of God was upon my tabernacle. Job chapter number 20, actually let me turn there real quick, because I don't think that's the right verse that I wanted. Job chapter number 29, verse number 4. You can stay where you're at there. Job chapter number 29, verse number 4. Job chapter number 29, verse number 4. Yeah, I put the wrong verse down here, but Job says, I believe it's in chapter number 24, actually. Job says in chapter number 24, he says that he wishes that he was in the days of his youth. He says, when my children were yet about me. When my children were yet about me. Talking about while his children were still living at home with him. So, if you're at the age where if you had kids or if you have kids and your children would be there or are there still with you, the Bible considers that still the days of your youth. The Bible still considers that, you know, you being a youth. And if you're not at that age, you know, we can still take away from this that you should not despise the youth. You can still learn from the sermon. You can still learn from the warnings that were given to the believers, that were given to the church at Corinth, which said, let no man therefore despise him. Now, you're in Proverbs chapter number 22. Proverbs chapter number 22. And my first point was to understand that this is a warning. My second point is to the young man, to the youth, don't give people a reason to despise your youth. Because there's reasons, because you can create a reason that will cause someone to despise you because you're young. Look at Proverbs chapter number 22 and look at verse number 15. It says, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction shall drive it far from him. So it says in the beginning of verse number 15 there, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. If I were to ask, for people to give me a list of characteristics or a list of attributes of a child or even just someone in their youth, one of the things that you would say would be foolishness. And what this means here, what we would say probably today when this says foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, a lot of us, when we're talking about children in this sense, in this context, we would probably call it immaturity. We would probably say that children are immature. Children are oftentimes immature. They're childish. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. 1 Corinthians chapter number 13. And this is one of the ways that a young man, when he decides to serve God, that he can cause people, he can give people a reason to despise his youth. Number one, there was a warning. Hey, there's going to be people that will despise your youth. So if there's people that are already going to look at you, they're already waiting just to despise your youth, the last thing that you should be doing is giving them a reason. And one of the reasons why an older person could look at another person and despise their youth would be for foolishness, would be for being immature. And here's just another point, like I was talking about just a minute ago, of the definition of youth. Another angle to look at that is also that youth can be a relative term. If I went to someone's door, that's 30 years old, they may not so much see me, as a youth. Maybe they would, maybe they wouldn't at 26. If I was 40 years old and I went to a 90-year-old man's door, he would probably still say, yeah, he's in the years of his youth. He's still a youth. He would say, at least compared to me, he's still a youth. He would at least say that. So there's different definitions as well of what a youth could be. And also keep in mind that that could be relative. But 1 Corinthians chapter number 13, verse number 11, Paul speaking, he says this: when I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. So notice he calls there's certain things out there, he says, are childish things. There's certain things out there that are immature. There's certain things out there that children do that are just foolish. They're the types of things that children would do. They're childish. And what would fall into this category would be things like, of immaturity, would be things like irresponsibility, like being on time. That's kind of something that people expect from the youth, is to be late. They kind of expect them, to forget about things. They kind of expect them to not be mature enough, to take responsibility and to do stuff. So this is an area where you could just bring, you could just bring it upon yourself for someone to look at you. If you're a young man and you want to be in the ministry, where someone could just look at you and say, he's just a youth. He's always late. He's just a youth, he has no responsibility. He's just a youth, and just have all these other reasons. Something that just like is just infected our nation in just a crazy way is just, grown men, like I would call them grown men, but the Bible would refer to them still in their youth, of just being obsessed with video games and their games. They're games. And there's so many men that, they start out when they're a teenager, they start out when they're younger, and they never put away childish things. They're 30 years old, they're 35 years old, and they're sitting in their mother's basement drinking Mountain Dew and Red Bull and staying up all night playing video games with a headset on. Instead of being married, instead of getting a family, instead of going to church the next day, they stay up on a Saturday night and then sleep in till 3 o'clock. That would give a reason, that would provide a reason for someone to look at you when you say, oh, I'm serious about serving God. You know what I would say to a person like that, even myself? I would say, you're still a child. You're still a youth. You need to grow up. You need to get maturity. You need to become responsible. You're just a youth. That provides reasons. So when you have somebody, when you have the situation, the warning, that somebody's already going to despise your youth, you need to be more careful and make sure that you put away foolish things. Right. Make sure that you put away childish things. If you have a video game set, throw it away. Get rid of it. If you're a grown man, get rid of a video game set. Do not sit on your phone playing video games all the time. Memorize scripture. Don't sit on your phone playing video games. Don't get on the computer playing video games. Don't waste your time. It's just a game. It's vanity. The Bible says that childhood and youth is vanity. Remember now thy creator in the days of thy youth. All that other stuff is vanity. Video games are vanity. Put away childish things. Don't give people a reason to despise your youth. That's the number one reason why someone would despise your youth, is because you're immature. The number two reason, turn to Job chapter number 20, verse 10, is just by living a sinful life. Job chapter number 20, verse number 10. Job chapter number 20, verse number 10. When that said, you know, that foolishness is bound in the heart of the child, that can go two ways. That can be referring to just immaturity. That can be just referring to just childish things. But it also could be referring to living a sinful life. And very often, you know, if you talk to somebody that's a saved person, if you talk to somebody that's, you know, living for God right now, even if they got saved when they were younger, oftentimes people will say, you know, the worst part of my life or the most sinful part of my life was in the days of my youth. That's what most people would say. Look at Job chapter number 20, verse number 10. It says, his children shall seek to please the poor, and his hands shall restore their goods. Verse number 11, his bones are full of the sin of his youth, which shall lie down with him in the dust. So when he talks about, you know, a sinful life of a man, he specifically says his bones are full of the sin of his youth. That's because most of the sin that people commit, if you were to look at the majority of people's lives, and when they live the most sinful life, even just the world, normally is in the days of their youth. And if you want to give people a reason to look at you and to despise your youth when they're already looking for a reason, live a sinful life. That would give them a reason to look at you and just despise your youth. And just say, he's just a youth. You know, this is understandable because he's just a youth. You know, he's just sowing his wild oats, right? That's what people will say oftentimes. That's because during the years of people's youth, normally they live a more sinful life. And if you want to serve God, it's time to put away childish things. It's time to put away foolishness. And it's time to put away, you know, the sinful life. It's Amen. Time to start walking in God's statutes and walking in God's commandments and walking in the light of God's Word. Look at another example in Psalms chapter number 25, verse number 7. Psalms chapter number 25, verse number 7. David says, remember not the sins of my youth, nor my transgressions, according to thy mercy. Remember thou me for thy goodness' sake, O Lord. So notice when he wants to bring up the sin of his life, he specifically brings up, don't remember the sin of my youth. Because I'm sure David had a lot more sins, and he lived a much more sinful life in the days of his youth. Isaiah chapter number 54, verse number 4 says this, fear not, for thou shalt not be ashamed, speaking unto just Israel. Neither be thou confounded, for thou shalt not be put to shame. Watch what he says, for thou shalt forget the shame of thy youth, and shalt not remember the reproach of thy widowhood anymore. And a shame of your youth, and a shame of most people's youth, a lot of people can look back at their life, and they feel shameful about what they've done when they were younger. They feel shameful about a lot of the decisions and a lot of the years that they lived in the days of their youth. And like I said, the second reason that someone could look at you and despise your youth is for living a sinful life, is for the shames of your youth. Now turn to Judges chapter number 8, verse number 20. We'll look at the third reason. Judges chapter number 8, verse number 20. Can you get daddy water? Judges chapter number 8, verse number 20. These are things that are common reasons why someone could look at you and despise your youth. People are born a certain way. There's a certain nature about things. And when children are growing up, they have a certain nature. They have a sin nature. They have, you know, they're born foolish. But there's also one other characteristic. Look at number 20 here. It says, and he said, verse number 20, and he said unto Jether, his firstborn, up and slay them. But the youth drew not his sword. Now watch why. For, meaning because, he feared because he was yet a youth. So God even explains it. Even God says, this is understandable. This is common. He says, he drew not his sword, for, meaning because, saying this is a reason, because he was yet a youth. So the reason why Jether here, the reason why, you know, his firstborn, his youngest, didn't draw his sword and didn't do what his father commanded him was because he was afraid. And this is another reason why you could cause someone to look at you and to despise your youth, is to be fearful, is to be afraid. Because a lot of the things, as far as, you know, serving God, if you want to do great things, if you wanted to be a pastor, you know, you have to get over fear. You have to get over standing behind a pulpit and preaching to people. You have to get over the fear if you wanted to be a great soul winner. You have to get over the fear of going to the door and knocking on the door and speaking to a stranger. A lot of people have that fear, and even more so the youth. Because they're youth, because they're younger, they're more afraid of things. And this is another reason why you could cause someone to look at you and to despise your youth, because you're afraid. Look at, turn back to 1 Samuel chapter number 17. And I'll tell you this, I've never had more people. If you want to be a great soul winner and you're in your youth and you want to test this or make an experiment with this verse and see if this is true, I've never had more people despise my youth than when I'm out soul winning. When I go soul winning out constantly, you know, people, at least I'd say like at least once every 6 months, I get some like snarky comment about how young I am. I receive some, you know, comment from some older guy about, you know, about being in your youth. And not only me, but people that I'm with constantly, because our church is full with a bunch of young men, a bunch of young women. So men that I'm with all the time, I hear them constantly just receiving, you know, flack about their age, just bringing up their age. Now, like I said, look at 1 Samuel chapter number 17. Then we're going back to the passage with David, because David is a good example of this. David was a good example of someone who wasn't afraid, who wasn't fearful. Now, keep in mind one thing. David was fighting a physical battle. David was fighting a physical war. In the New Testament, we do not fight a physical war. The Bible says that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're spiritual. You know, we fight a spiritual battle. But also keep in mind, this is the point that I wanted to make here in this statement, but also keep in mind that David was not only fighting a physical battle, David at that time was also fighting a spiritual battle. And the reason why David wasn't afraid was because David wasn't looking upon carnal things. David was looking at spiritual things. And when everyone looked at David, and all those men looked at David, his brother, Saul, Goliath, the reason why they despised David, and the reason why they thought that David would lose the battle and would lose the fight and could not defeat Goliath, was because they were carnally minded. Now look at 1 Samuel chapter number 17, and yeah, we'll read in verse number 42. Verse number 42, it says, "And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. And the Philistine said unto David, Am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his God. And the Philistine said to David, Come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air, to the beasts of the field. Then said David to the Philistine, Thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee. And I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel." Nobody could read this passage and think for a second that David was afraid. It's very, very, it's very clear that David is very bold and David is very confident that he's not going to lose this battle. Look at verse number 47, the last one. "And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear," watch this, "for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." So the reason why David isn't afraid is because David was not looking upon physical things. David was not looking upon carnal things. David was trusting in God. And you know what we can learn from this as well? There were three people that despised David's youth. We had two of them which were probably saved, and one of them which was not saved. I would assume that David's brother was saved. I would assume that, because David was brought up well. David was a man after God's own heart. I would assume that his dad did a good job of raising his children, and that two of them are saved and one of them's not. And let me say this, when I go out soul winning, and people despise my youth, or I see other men that I'm with have their youth despised for that reason, most of the time it's from other saved men. Mm-hmm. And we see here 2 out of 3 times. Most of the time when I'm out soul winning, it's from other people or other men that are saved. And I'll tell you why. We learn from the Philistine here. We learn from the unsaved man why he thought that he was going to win the battle. And not only that, why he was despising David's youth. It was because he was looking upon fleshly things, because he was mocking his size, because he was mocking his age. So that tells me the same thing about the other two. And that's pretty sad that the same reason why some unsaved man, if I knock on his door and he despised my youth, and then I knocked on 2 other doors and 2 saved men despised my youth, that the reason why they would do so is because they're walking in the flesh, because they're looking upon things of this world, because they're carnally minded. Oftentimes, and I'm going to use this to segue into my next point. Turn to Jeremiah chapter 1. Jeremiah chapter 1. Oftentimes, God will call young men to do work for Him. God will call young men. If He has a job to do, oftentimes He'll commission a young man to do it. A very young man, very often. Just like we saw David as a youth. Look here in Jeremiah chapter 1, and look at verse 4. It says, "Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child." So Jeremiah, while being called, is a young man. Child in the Bible, is used even up until their teens. David was called a child when he was 17 years old. I would say that Jeremiah was probably 16, 17 years old. He was definitely a youth. He was definitely at the age where people would look at him and despise him. Now, notice his reaction too. Notice how he reacts when God says that I ordained thee, I sanctified thee, as a prophet to go forth and preach. Notice his reaction. "Then said I, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child." He's afraid. You remember in Judges 8:20? How it talked about, and that was my third point, not to be afraid. That's a reason why you could cause people to despise your youth. And God told Jeremiah as well, he tells him to go forth and to preach and to not be afraid of their faces. And then he tells him this, look at verse 7. "But the Lord said unto me, Say not I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee thou shalt speak." Now watch verse 8. "Be not afraid of their faces, because I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord." So why was he not to be afraid? It didn't matter what age that he was. It didn't matter how young he was. The reason why he was not to be afraid was the same reason why David wasn't afraid. Was because he was trusting in God. Because God said, "I'm with you and you don't have anything to worry about. I will be there." Don't look upon carnal things. It doesn't matter how old you are. It matters, spiritual things are what matter. It's a spiritual warfare. It's not a carnal warfare that we fight. Now, like I said, in verse 6, it says, "Then said I, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child." So, this was going along with my third point. He was afraid, but God told him not to be afraid. And that's the third reason, my final reason, on why someone could despise your youth. But this was my next point, is God often calls young men into the ministry. When God has work to do, He doesn't normally go and get the old man. He won't normally go and get a very old man. That's just the fact of the Bible. And this just proves even further that these guys that you knock on their door are walking in the flesh. The fact that they don't know their Bible. The fact that they don't know that David was a youth. David was a young man and was a man after God's own heart. And was one of the greatest Bible characters, if not the greatest, in the Bible and was a young man. The fact that Jeremiah was called as a child. So it just shows, number 1, they don't know all the commandments where they say, "Let no man therefore despise him." Where it's written to a Christian not to despise a young man, not to despise a youth. Then they don't know all the passages. All these men don't know the passages where God calls a young man into the ministry. And I'll be perfectly honest with you, the last group of people that I want advice from today, as far as Christianity, as far as spirituality, is the current IFB pastors. Yeah. And that's who is the most, you know, that's who it's the most prevalent for despising the youth. And you know why you don't see many youth pastors today? Why you don't see many, and I don't mean pastoring the youth, I mean young pastors today, is because they're looked down upon. It's because they're mocked and they're ridiculed. They're basically pushed and discouraged out of the ministry. And you want to know why it's so funny that they're the ones that are despising the youth and why they're the ones that try to look down upon other people? It's because of the fact that it's obvious, number one, that they don't know their Bible. And it's obvious, and then the point number two, my main point, is that they're the one that hasn't put away childish things. They're the one that's still a child like Jeremiah, and they're afraid of their faces. Now, I would much rather have a young man get up behind the pulpit who's trusting in God and who's not afraid to preach the Bible than to have one of these old buffoons who, number one, doesn't know his Bible, and then, number two, is too scared because of his deacons or too scared because of all the people to be thrown out of the church.
Amen.
That's not the attitude that Jeremiah had. And it just proves over and over again that you're walking in the flesh. That you're carnally minded. That all these pastors, these IFB pastors who are puffed up and they look down upon young men, it just shows that they don't know their Bible. And just like David said, I have more understanding than all my teachers. I probably, and I'm not being puffed up by saying this, I'm saying this because I've seen, you know, the knowledge and I've seen the stupidity come out of all their mouths. I'm not saying that I'm great. But I probably know my Bible at 26 years old than the majority of 50 and 60 year old men. And I'm not saying that I'm just the greatest Bible scholar. I'm saying they don't know their Bibles.
Amen.
I'm saying they need to read their Bibles. They need to, you know, they need to shut up and sit down and let a young man get behind the pulpit nowadays. That's what we need.
Amen.
We need to flood this nation with a bunch of young men who aren't afraid of their faces, who aren't afraid to get behind the pulpit, and they're not afraid to preach on sin. They aren't afraid to preach on subjects that the last guy was afraid to preach on. They got to get in there and they need to fix all the problems that this guy allowed, you know, to get into the church. All the leaven, the little leaven that leavens the whole lump. They need to get in there, and like Jeremiah had to do here, and they need to get in there and they need to pull down, they need to break down, and then they need to rebuild. They need to fix the problems of this last failed IFB generation. These last pastors. Now turn in your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter number 4, verse 12 again. 1 Timothy chapter number 4, verse 12 again. I want to point something out about this. Look at the context, verse number 11. When he tells him not to let someone despise his youth, he says, "These things command and teach, let no man despise thy youth." So you know when you're going to be more likely that someone despises your youth? When you get up behind the pulpit and preach. If you're just a youth and you come in and you just want to sit down and learn the Bible and you just come in and then leave, and you don't go soul winning, you're probably not going to have anybody despise your youth. When did David have someone despise his youth? When he stepped up and he's like, I'll kill this Philistine. Who is this guy? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? And then he said, "Thy servant will go," he told Saul. When he stepped up and he said, "I'll take the lead. I'll be a leader." That's when you're going to have somebody despise your youth. Just like Paul said, "These things command and teach, let no man despise thy youth." You know when someone's going to despise your youth? When you start giving commands. When you start trying to teach the Bible. And that's why people normally get offended at the door. And they answer very arrogantly. And they like to throw out, you know, all these like demeaning and condescending statements like, "My daughter thinks it's hilarious when anybody calls me boy or kid or anything like that." And that's what they'll often say. Like, "I've been saved for 20 years, boy." It's like they're just demonstrating a puffed up attitude. Like, "You're just showing me. Okay, Saul. You're just like Saul. That's what you're showing me." The Bible teaches, "Let no man despise thy youth." About 5 years ago, I went to preach at, I preached at a nursing home, and there was another guy who was a Baptist who was after us. And he was like, "Hey man, you want to come preach at my church tonight? You did a really good job." So I was like, "Sure, I don't know the church, but I'll go preach. I'm not listening to somebody else preach. It might not be all that great of a church. If it's a Baptist church, I'll go preach there." So I showed up, and the pastor, this really old man, walked up to me, and he was like, "You preaching?" And I was like, "Yeah." He was like, "You're pretty young." You know what I said? "Let no man despise thy youth." That's what I quoted to him. He was like, "All right." And then he just walked away. Said nothing else to me. That was literally all that he said. Walked away. But it's common. When you want to take a position of leadership, well, I was coming, because the guy that invited me, he sat in and preached a lot, and it was his night to preach. He wasn't the pastor. And then the pastor was the one that walked up to me. And he's the one that said that to me. So if you want to go and you want to preach and you want to go soul winning and you want to take a position of leadership, that's when people will despise your youth. Mm-hmm. That's when you start commanding and teaching, that's when someone's going to say, you're just a youth. You're not able to lead. You're not able to do it. Turn, look again. You'll see this one more time. If you look at Titus chapter number 2. Titus chapter number 2. Look at Titus chapter number 2 and look at verse number 15. Watch when he tells him, let no man despise thee. These things speak and exhort and rebuke, and watch this, with all authority, let no man despise thee. You know when someone's going to despise you? When you command and teach. You know when someone's going to despise you? When you rebuke them. When you teach with authority as a young man. People just tend to look down upon the young. They look down upon the youth. That's what they do. They look down upon the youth. So it's a warning. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. So point number 1 was, this is a warning to let no man despise you. If you want to do great things for God, people will despise you. You will be despised, for sure, because of your youth. Point number 2, don't give them a reason to despise you. Different reasons is foolishness. You know, being immature, being irresponsible. Also, living a sinful life like children often do. You know, living in sin, that's a reason why people would despise your youth. And then also being fearful, being afraid, that's a reason why you could cause someone to despise your youth. And then my point number 3, and that's where I'm going to end here in 1 Corinthians chapter number 1, was God often chooses young men to do work for him. Young men to do work for him. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. We'll begin reading in verse number 26. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world. Now watch this. And things which are despised hath God chosen. Yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto wise and righteousness, made unto wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. God often chooses the youth. God often chooses things which are despised, for the reason to bring to naught things which are. To bring down the people that are very puffed up. So keep all these things in mind. If you want to serve God and you're a young man, just be prepared that people will despise your youth. Even if you're a young woman and you want to serve God and you're young and you go knock on someone's door and you want to go soul winning, people will despise your youth. So understand, it's a warning. Number 2, don't give them a reason. Don't give them a reason to despise your youth. And understand that God often chooses people when they're young. He often chooses the youth to do the work for them. Let's bow our heads and have a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father God, we thank you for this day, dear Lord, and we ask you to bless the rest of the day. We thank you for your word, God, and we thank you just for giving us an opportunity, even in our young years and in the days of our youth, just to serve you with all our heart and all our mind and all our strength, dear Lord. We ask you that you would just bless the services later today, and bless the soul winning that's going to go on. We ask that you would give a spirit in all those that are the young and that are the youth that are willing and wanting to serve God, where they wouldn't be discouraged, where they would still still just serve you with all their heart. They wouldn't be discouraged, by those that would look down upon them and despise their youth. We love you, and like I said, and just be with us and bless us. And in Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.